بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. نعم، يقول مؤلف رحمه الله تعالى: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، كتاب التوحيد. We're going to start this book inshallah ta'ala immediately with the statement of the mu'allif, the author. And the way the author began this book is the way in which many musannifun, many authors in Islam, they begin their book, which is they'll start with three things. And what are those three things? Number one, basmala, meaning bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Number two, to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number three, to send salutations, blessings and peace upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it began with basmala. And it did this, and many authors that do this for what reason? Iqtida'an bi kitabillah. Following the example of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. Every single surah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except for Surah Al-Bara'a, starts with what? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And likewise, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are two types: sunnah fi'liyah, sunnah of the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wal-qawliyah, the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when we look at the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning basmala, he said, كُلُّ أَمْرٍ ذِي بَالٍ لَمْ يُبْدَأَ فِيهِ بِبَسْمَلَةٍ فَهُوَ أَبْتَرٍ. Any important issue or affair that doesn't begin with bismillah, فَهُوَ أَبْتَرٍ. What is the meaning of abtar? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. It is devoid of barakah. And when we look at the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his correspondences, in his letters, it will begin with what? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the author did this for this reason. Now what is the meaning of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Bismillah, it means in the name of Allah, the creator of the heaven and the earth. So when you say Bismillah, is it only in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or in all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There's a principle here. Mudaf, anything which is a possessive noun, which is singular, in reality is plural. Because when you say in the name of Allah, does a specific name or attribute of Allah come to your mind? No. So when you say Bismillah, it means in all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the meaning of Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Sifatan, the two attributes of Allah. تَدُلُّ عَلَى مَاذَا عَلَى الرَّحْمَةِ. That proves the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They both denote the attribute of mercy. But there's a difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. As for Ar-Rahman, مِنَ الْأَسْمَاءَ الْمُخْتَصَّ بِاللَّهِ. It's from those names that's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Rahim, can a human being be named Rahim? Not necessarily Abdurrahim, but Rahim. Can he be described as being Rahim? نعم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفُ رَحِيمٌ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is ra'uf, full of pity, and rahim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الرَّاحِمُونَ, those people who are merciful, he called them rahimun, يَرْحَمُهُمُ الرَّحْمَنُ. But as for Rahman, it's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, الرَّحْمَن, it means vast mercy. Because anything that comes as on the scale of fu'lan in Arabic language, meaning jaw'an, za'lan, ghadban, it means vast. Because in Arabic, you could say, أنا جائع, I'm hungry. Or you could say, أنا جوعان. That means I'm very hungry. So it means الرحمة الواسعة. So this is the meaning of Basmala. But in this context now, what does Bismillah mean? When you say Bismillah, متعلق بفعل محذوف مناسب للمقام. Anytime you say Bismillah, it is connected to a verb or an action that's not expressed, but it is there. So when you say Bismillah and you drink, the action of drinking is there, but it's not mentioned. Meaning you're saying, in the name of Allah, I drink. So depending on the context, it has different meaning. So when I am reading, I say Bismillah. What is the action? In the name of Allah, I read. So when the author says Bismillah Rahman Rahim, what is the missing verb here? In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I write this book. Musta'inan billah, seeking the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you step out of your house daily and you say Bismillahi, what are you doing? I step out musta'inan billah. I step out of my house seeking the assistance of Allah. Thus why the authors, they always put Bismillah Rahman Rahim, musta'inan billah, seeking the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After that, he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then sends salvation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, when the scholars write a book and they do these three things, what comes after that? Or even any book, what do you normally read in the beginning of a book? Introduction, preface, foreword. The author here, there's no foreword, there's no introduction, there's no subject matter. He began the book straight away saying Kitabu Tawheed. Why? Seldom or hardly will you find a book that doesn't have an introduction into what the book is about. But he didn't put no introduction whatsoever. He just said Kitabu Tawheed. And in doing this, he's gone against the ways of many authors. Only one author has ever done this. The reason for this is because At-Tawheed qad bayyanahu Allah Ta'ala. The issue of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so clear. And this is the effect of Tawheed upon the heart. That this issue is so clear, it doesn't need an introduction. Wa min mura'ati al-adab, from etiquettes, they say the scholars, an la yakun fasilan بين الحق والدال على الحق ودليل الحق. That there should be no partition, no interjection between the truth, the guide to the truth, and the proof of the truth. And what is the truth? Tawheed, that Allah Ta'ala is one. Who is the guide to the truth? Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And what is the proof of the truth? The words of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So therefore, the author, he didn't begin with any introduction. He just said, Kitabu Tawheed, straight into the topic. And the only author to have done this likewise is Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Sahih al-Bukhari, does he have an introduction? Does he have sabab al-ta'lif, why he authored it? After Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah, he just brings the first hadith, Innama al-A'malu bin-Niyat. So the author says, Kitabu al-Tawheed. The book, Kitab means book of Tawheed. Kitab here meaning al-Maktub, what has been written, wa jumi'a, and what has been compiled concerning bayan wujub al-Tawheed, the obligation of Tawheed. Now many a times we use this word Tawheed, Tawheed, Tawheed. What is the meaning of Tawheed? For those who attended the previous classes, mashallah ta'ala, Abu Amatillah, Muhammad Bilal, they will know the meaning of Tawheed. But inshallah ta'ala, in the next lesson, we'll test them. Anytime you define something in Islam, you have to define it linguistically, according to the language, and also istilahan. For those taking notes, at-tawheed lughatan. Tawheed linguistically. What is tawheed lughatan? At-tawheed lughatan, masdar. It is the root verb of the verb wahada yuwahidu. The root verb of to make something one or single. Wahada. This is the meaning of Tawheed linguistically. To make something one. To make something become one. That's the linguistic meaning, not the Sharia meaning. Now this word Tawheed, does it come as it is, even linguistically? Or Shara'an, Istilahan. Do we find this in the Quran? Do we find it in the Sunnah? or the derivatives of Tawheed? Do we find it in the Quran? Naam, we find it. Many ayats in the Quran, either wahidun or wahdahu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa ilahukum ilahun wahid. And the one you worship, your God, is one. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, another ayat, wahdahu, he alone. And do we find the verb tawheed also in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Naam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal to Yemen. He said, innaka taqdam ala qawmin min ahli al-kitab. You're going to come across the people of the book. فَلْيَكُنْ Let it be. أَوَّلُ مَا تَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ يُوَحِّدُ اللَّهِ Let the first thing you call them to, and يُوَحِّدُ اللَّهِ To single out Allah alone for worship. So the word tawheed, or the derivatives of it, the verbs, is in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Umar in Bukhari and Muslim. بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسِ Islam is built upon five pillars. In one narration, it says, shahadatu an la ilaha illallah. In another narration is, an yuwahid Allah. An yuwahidullah. To single out Allah alone for worship. So shahada and tawheed are what? Synonyms of one another. So this is the linguistic meaning of at-tawheed. What is the technical meaning of tawheed? Tawheed is, as Shaykh al-Islam bin Taymiyyah said, diddu shirk, the opposite of shirk. To associate partners or take rivals unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أو إفراد الله بخصائصه. Tawheed is إفراد الله. To single out Allah alone with that which is for Allah alone. And what are those things that are specific for Allah? سواء كان في ربوبيته. In the lordship of Allah. So number one, to single out Allah alone in that which is for him, in his lordship. Number two, in his uluhiyya, in his divinity. And number three, in his asma wa sifat, names and attributes. So therefore, tawheed is how many categories? Three. First, tawheed ar-rububiyya, the lordship of Allah. What does it mean when we say Allah Ta'ala is the only Lord? Meaning al-khaliq is the only creator. Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah created everything. And the creation of Allah, or the creating of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, min adamin, from nothing. Allah ta'ala, yuhyi wa yumit, is the only one that gives life, it gives death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mudabbir al-umur, is the one that controls all the affairs of the heavens and the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa razzaq, he is the provider. And if you look at the majority of the people, including the mushrikeen, the polytheists, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and today, this particular aspect of tawheed, they don't deny it. They accept it. The second category is tawheed al-ibadah. This was the cause of disputes between the messengers and their people. And this is the cause of dispute in the ummah today. That many people, they don't understand tawheed al-ibadah, the oneness of Allah in his worship. And that is to dedicate all acts of worship only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From dua, from raja, hope, from at-tawakkul, putting your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the last category is tawheed asma wa sifat. Allah's oneness in his names and attributes. Meaning there's attributes and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only for Allah. Even if we share the same names in those attributes, laysa kamithlihi shay. There's nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the author says, Kitabu at-Tawheed, that which has been compiled concerning the obligation of at-Tawheed. Now, when the author here mentions Kitabu at-Tawheed, is he having in mind a specific category of Tawheed or order Tawheed? What do you think? A specific Tawheed, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. Only the Tawheed of oneness of Allah in his worship. Because the issue of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, people have no issue with this, that Allah is the Lord. But it means by this Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Allah's oneness in divinity, or Tawheed al-Ibadah, Allah's oneness in worship. So therefore, it brings seven evidences to support the title of the book, Kitab al-Tawheed. I'm going to go through each and every one of these evidences, inshallah ta'ala. So the author immediately, he says, يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وما خلقت الجن. I have not created the jinn and the mankind except ليعبدون, to worship me. Where is the proof of Tawheed al-Ibadah, that only Allah alone should be worshipped in this verse? Allah Ta'ala said, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to worship me. Where is the proof here of Tawheed, that only Allah Azza wa Jal should be worshipped? The proof is this. When the word Ibadah is mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah, it refers to Tawheed. When you see the word Ibadah, why? Because any act of worship that a person does and he associates partners with Allah in it, can we still call it ibadah, an act of worship? So if a person makes dua and he goes to the grave and he asks the person in the grave and he makes dua to them, can we say, and he asks Allah also, along with the person in the grave, he also asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is this dua, is it an act of worship or not an act of worship? It's not an act of worship. Why? Allah Ta'ala says, "Man amila," in a hadith Qudsi, "amalan ashraka ma'iya ghayri taraktuhu." Whoever does any deed and he associate partners with me in that action, I abandon him. Does Allah say taraktuhu ibadata? I abandon him in his ibadah. Allah said taraktuhu wa shirka. I abandon him in his shirk. So any act a person does that has shirk in it is not ibadah. So the meaning, therefore, إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to worship, it means except to single me at Allah alone for worship. And that's why when it comes to this ayah, the tafsir of the ulama of tafsir, they say إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, it means إِلَّا لِيَوَحِدُونَ, except to single at Allah alone for worship. Some of the other ulama, they say إِلَّا لِيَقُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, except to say لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, أو لِيَشْهَدُوا, to bear witness of La ilaha illallah. So this ayah is a proof of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because illa liya'budun, worship is a tawheed. Now when we look at this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَلَا وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَالرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينُ. Allah Ta'ala says, مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ, I do not seek any provision from them, any sustenance from them, or to feed me. Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Because he, Allah, is al-Razzaq, the possessor of firm strength that provides for the whole of his creation. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost made it known, he created the whole of the creation, the mankind and jinn. Not only did he create them, he created them for what purpose? To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or in other words, to do what? What's the purpose of creation? To do what? To worship Allah only? To worship Allah alone. Because ibadah is tawheed. So anybody who worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worships others along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not fulfilled the purpose of creation. Because إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, to single out Allah alone for worship. This is the importance of this topic of Tawheed. This is the purpose of creation. That to single out Allah alone for worship. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he doesn't seek from them provisions or sustenance. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the provider. Now when we look at this ayah, I don't want to quote or mention the ayah without looking at the benefits of it. The fawaid of this ayah, the benefit is hikma min khalqi al-jinn, the wisdom of the creation or behind the creation of the jinn and the mankind, which is what? What's the wisdom? Ifradullah, to single out Allah alone for worship. Number two is the affirmation of wujud al-jinn, the presence of jinn. Number three, كَمَالْ غِنَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ أَنْ خَلْقِهِ, Allah is not in need of his creation. Number four, أَنَّ مَصْدَرَ الرِّزْقِ مِنَ اللَّهِ, سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ, that the root or the source of all provision is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is from the thamarat or the fruits of at-tawheed. A person who has tawheed, he firmly believes the risk is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does the necessary things, but he knows risk min indillah. Number five, ithbat ismain min asma'illah. He affirms the two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-razaq wal-mateen. Tayyib. The next evidence, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. That we've sent in every single nation a messenger saying, أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ. Now we repeated it many times. A messenger saying, worship Allah. When these messages came and said, أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ, worship Allah, every single messenger. What is the meaning of worship Allah? Singular Allah alone for worship. Because the mushrikeen that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to, were they worshipping Allah? Na'am. But others along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people of Ibrahim, were they worshipping Allah? Na'am. But others along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, أَنِّعْبُدُ اللَّهُ وَاجْتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. And stay away from الطَّاغُوتِ. Those who transgress the boundaries of Allah in terms of being worshipped or being obeyed. The next verse, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he brings the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرْ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الظُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ, your Lord has decreed. And this decree here, is it a decree or a will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kawniyya, that Allah decreed it as ordained that is going to happen? Or is it a legislative decree? Because there's things Allah decrees, how long you're going to live for, your provision, everything. This is decree of Allah in His creation, and that must come to pass. So this decree here, is it a decree like that, or is it a decree in terms of a legislative decree? A legislative one. Because not everyone worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So qada huna qada'un shir'i. Allah has legislated, has commanded that alla ta'budu, that you do not worship except for Him. Wa bil walidayn ihsana, and to be kind or to be good to your parents. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rights of the parents after the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And kindness to the parents, very important for a person who claims to be muwahid upon tawheed, to know that the greatest right after the right of Allah Azza wa Jal is the right of your parents. And this is why we teach our children, we teach our wives, we teach our family at tawheed. And it is shocking, not many people focus on tawheed. So you could have children upon what? Upon the oneness of Allah Azza wa Jal, and a child upon tawheed is the best of children to their parents. When you understand the haqq of Allah Azza wa Jal immediately after is the right of the parents. That when we pass away and our children remain upon tawheed, they'll be making dua for us as in this ayah. رَبِّ رَحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. Oh Allah, have mercy upon them. كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ. The same way they cultivated me, nurtured me. What is cultivation of children? What is nurturing of children? Feeding, clothing, education. Is that all? The biggest tarbiyah, the biggest or the best cultivation or the best thing you could give to your children is tawheed. That's the best thing you could give to them. And the biggest loss if for your children not to be upon tawheed. كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. The same way they cultivated me upon tawheed. And that's why the author of the book, Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah azza wa jal, when he had reached the old age and the adhan was called, and his children went to pray, and he was asking, أَيْنَ Abdullah? His son's name was Abdullah. And the rest of the children, they said they've left, they're going to pray. He said, Alhamdulillah, الَّذِي جَعَلَ مِنْ صَلْبِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُهُ. Indeed, all praise is due to Allah, that has made from me children that worship Allah alone. So when we see young people in the masjid today, Alhamdulillah, you have children that worship Allah Azza wa Jal. So bi walidayni ihsana, to be kind to your parents. Wal qiyam And being kind to them is to do everything that helps them. Dua lahuma, making dua for them, asking Allah Ta'ala to forgive them. Silatul rahim, keeping the ties of kinship. And also Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says that when they get old, عندك, when they reach an old age, we don't chuck our parents in old people's home. Our parents never chucked us to nannies or to someone to just look after us. When they get old with you, in your presence, and then Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَ أُفْ. أُفْ means anytime your mother or father, they order you something, seek something from you, do not show any discomfort, any frustration, because the reality of those who've lost their parents, they will tell you, subhanAllah, I've not spoken to any brother who's lost their mother or their father, except they said, I wish I only did more. And it's too late sometimes. So when they tell you something, don't show any discomfort whatsoever. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفْ. And from the benefits of this tawheed, subhanAllah, that true kindness to your parents, for those who have non-Muslim parents, or those who have parents who are not practicing, true kindness to them and goodness to them, you could bring them to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I remember a brother, an older brother who was older than me, our brother Sadiq, from our community. He had been Muslim for over 20 years, giving da'wah to his father. His father doesn't want to hear anything about Islam. He doesn't want to hear Assalamu alaikum even, not even Bismillah. So when the brother migrated to Mecca, he used to call his father, but to call his father, he has to call another brother in England to collect that call. His dad doesn't want to see +96, +971, 974. This is how much he hated Islam. So Sadiq, on this particular day, Ba'da Salatu Fajr, was at the Haram. He called his father. And he doesn't want to hear Salaamu Alaikum, nothing. He called his father, he was in the Haram. This is after 20 years. And he used to always keep relationship with his father, even though his father was hostile, always kept relation with him. So Sadiq, he called his father after Fajr, it was at the Haram. But this day, his father was different. He was listening to him. So he thought, you know what, let me take this opportunity, maybe mention Islam, but you know the next thing you're going to hear is the dialing tone, doom. So he said, let me just say something to him. And he said something to his father, and his father listened. And he thought, let me actually stop here, or should I continue? And he continued. He said, Father, Dad, do you believe in everything I'm saying? His dad said, I believe. He said, do you bear witness there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah alone, and that Muhammad is his messenger? He said, naam. Sadiq, he left the Haram. He went home to his wife. He was so happy. Upon reaching home, his wife said, have you heard the news about your father? In his head, the news is what? His father's accepted Islam. She said, your father just passed away. Subhanallah. And from the fadl of this tawheed, a person who dies upon this tawheed, وَمَا عَمِلَ شَيْئًا قَطْ. He didn't do a single thing. And he died upon tawheed. Immediately before the obligation of salah or the time of salah came upon him or Ramadan, يدخل الجنة, enters the paradise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا عَمِلَ شَيْئًا قَطْ. Didn't do nothing. And the opposite, a person does a lot, but a shirk in the actions, subhanallah, no jannah. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. The hikmah or the fawaid from this ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is number one, wujub ifradullah bil ibadah, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone for worship. The obligation of being kind, of being good to our parents. And that general care of people and is in al-Islam, of the society. After that, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa'budu Allah wa la tushriku bihi shay'a. Worship Allah wa la tushriku bihi shay'a. And this ayah, worship Allah and do not associate partners with Him, is the meaning of La ilaha illallah. Worship Allah, do not associate partners with Him. Where is illallah in this ayah? Wa'budu Allah, illallah. Where is La ilaha? La tushriku bihi shay'a. Do not associate partners of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa bil walidaini ihsana. Wa bi dhil qurba wal yatama wal masakin wal jar. And show kindness to the people of relation, close relationship with you, the orphans, the poor, al-jar, your neighbor who is near to you in relation, wajar, or strange neighbor, and ibn al-sabil, the wayfarer, wa malakat aymanukum, and that which your right hand they possess. The next evidence the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala he brings is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah ta'ala says, قُلْ تَعَالَوْ أَتْلُ مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. That come, let me recite upon you that which my Lord has made impermissible for you. أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. That you do not associate partners with him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After that, the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, the next evidence it brings is the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in which he mentions that kuntu radifa an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala himarin faqal ya Mu'adh, that I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam riding behind him on an animal. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh, atadri ma haqqullahi ala al-ibad wa haqqu al-ibad ala Allah. Do you know the right of Allah upon the servants and the right of the servants upon Allah, a right which Allah obligated upon himself? He said, Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam. Allah and his messenger knows best. And since we're on the issue of tawheed, when it comes to Allah wa rasuluhu a'lam, is it permissible to say this in all things or only in things related to sharia? Only in things related to sharia, not things related to the creation. For example, will it rain tomorrow? Can I say Allah and his messenger knows best? La, because ilmu ghayb. Is this halal or haram? Can I say Allah wa rasuluhu a'lam? Naam, relating to sharia. And this is why the sahabi radiallahu an, he said Allah wa rasuluhu a'lam, because that which Allah or the Prophet says is the same as that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said when it comes to the sharia. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, حق الله على العباد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is right. الحق, the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, على العباد, upon the servants, أن يعبدوه, they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ولا يشركوا به شيئا, and they should not associate partners with him. وحق عباد على الله, and the right of the servants upon Allah, أن لا يعذب ما لا يشرك به شيئا, that Allah will not punish anybody that doesn't associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. The next evidence he brings is the statement of the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, in which he mentions, man arada, actually that was previous, man arada, whoever wills or wants to look at the wasiyyah. The wasiyyah here is the will of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was the previous ayah. فَيَنْظُرْ, let him read the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ تَعَالَوْ, let me read that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made impermissible upon you. InshaAllah ta'ala, with these ayahs, with the introduction to at-tawheed, we'll pause here bi-ibnillahi ta'ala. And the Shaykh after this, he mentioned al-masail, important topics concerning that which we have read today, inshaAllah ta'ala. I'll go through just some of those important topics with the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala he mentioned. Al-mas'ala, the first topic which the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala he mentions is al-hikmah min khalq al-jinn wal-ins. The first important topic is the reason or the wisdom behind the creation of mankind and jinn. And what is that wisdom? Ifradullah bi'ibadah, to single out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone for worship. Number two, ibadah is synonymous with what? At-tawheed, single out Allah azza wa jal alone for worship. Therefore, whoever, no matter how much act of worship he does or she does, has not singled out Allah alone for worship, has not worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not ibadah. Number three, the wisdom behind sending the messengers of Allah. And what is the wisdom behind the messengers, or the messengers? Tawheed. And this shows the importance of this topic. That when you look at all the books Allah ta'ala revealed, he revealed it for tawheed. Jannah wa nar was created for what reason? Because of tawheed. All the messengers of Allah, from Nuh to Muhammad, because of tawheed. Al-jihad fi sabilillah was legislated because of what? Because of tawheed. It shows the importance of Tawheed. Number five, that the message of Tawheed was delivered to all nations. Number six, that the Prophet's religion or the religion of the Anbiya is one in its root, a Tawheed. The importance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you could never establish the worship of Allah except you reject Tawhid. And that's why the Shahada is negation and affirmation. So a person is never upon Tawheed until he rejects anything that's worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned about Ibrahim. Lakum uswatun hasana. Idim is a good example. He didn't just say, look, you worship what you worship, worship Allah Azza wa Jal. Nah. What did he say to them? Inna bura'a'u minkum. We are free and we disavow ourselves from you and that which you worship, min dunillah. Kafarna bikum. We reject you. And that which you worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wabada baynana wa baynakum al-adawa wal-baghda abadan. There's permanent hatred between us and you. Abadan. Forever. Until you worship Allah alone. Number seven, I think. Tawhut, we hear many times, it refers to anything which has gone beyond the boundaries of Allah, from that which is worshipped or obeyed or followed. Number nine, the muhkamat, the 18 issues contained in Surah Al-Isra. Inshallah ta'ala, next week, bi-ibnillahi ta'ala, we'll continue with some of these important topics and then we'll move on bi-ibnillahi ta'ala onto the next issue, which is Fadlu At-Tawheed, and that which he expiates from sins. How Tawheed, he expiates sins. But before next week, inshallah ta'ala, for those who are taking notes, some of the things that we did mention here today, to prepare you, we'll be asking questions on them. I noticed some people are not taking notes. Notes is very important. Because these fawa'id and these munaqashat, and I'll ask and I request from the brothers, inshallah, some of the ayats which I've mentioned, in fact, all the ayats which I've mentioned, I'll choose anybody next week, inshallah ta'ala, to explain them. Some of the kalimat, some of the words to explain them. Some of the mustalahat, the terminologies, inshallah ta'ala. So mashallah, it's like the brothers, they have the memory of Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala. No notes, mashallah. Barakallah feekum. So is there any questions, inshallah? No. The brother's asking about the issue of the jinn. That Allah ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقَتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That our interaction or our knowledge, should we know more about the jinn? Because normally what we hear about jinn is evil and how they affect people. First and foremost, this is a very important point, which is one of the fawa'id that's mentioned there. It's bad wujud al-jinn. Affirmation there is jinn. We have to believe that because Allah ta'ala said he created them. وَلَكِنْ الْجِنْ or their world, عَالَمُ الْجِنْ وَعَالَمُ الْجِنْ عَالَمُ الْغَيْبِ. It's an unseen world that we do not see. We believe they exist and believe in the effects of the jinn, but it's an unseen world. Therefore, when it comes to umur al-ghaybiyya, issues of the unseen, our reference is what? The book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So you find in the Quran and the sunnah, many issues or many things mentioned concerning the jinn. What they created from fire. The fact that they do exist, what they eat, how to protect yourself from the evil jinn. And I use the word evil jinn, not all the jinns are evil. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he mentions in Surah Al-Jinn, وَأَنَّ مِنَّا صَالِحُونَ وَمِنَّا دُونَ ذَلِكَ كُنَّا تَرَائِكَ قِدَدًا. That they're different groups of jinn. There's righteous ones and unrighteous ones. وَأَنَّ مِنَّا الْمُسْلِمُونَ وَمِنَّا الْقَاسِتُونَ فَمَنْ أَسْلَمَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ تَحَرَّوْا رَشَدًا. So there's groups of jinn. Some are Muslims, some are kuffar. Some are righteous, some are unrighteous, but they do exist. Because one of the things that people, because you don't see something, they reject the existence of jinn. So jinn, they do exist. And the effects or the evil effects of a jinn, they also do exist. Barakallahu feekum. Naam. 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 Barakallahu feekum. A very good question as well, which should help us, inshallah, to memorize these categories of Tawheed. We said the category of Tawheed are three. Tawheed al-Rububiyya, Tawheed al-Uluhiyya al-Ibadah, or Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat. On all these three categories, you find it in Surah Al-Fatiha. For example, when you say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, this is which category of Tawheed? الربوبية, Allah's oneness in His lordship. When you say الرحمن الرحيم, this is توحيد of what? أسماء والصفات. Allah's oneness in His names and attributes. And إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين is توحيد of what? عبادة. Because you say only you Allah alone we worship. And where is the proof that you're saying only you Allah alone? Because when the subject or when the object precedes the subject, because in Surah Fatiha we don't say we worship you, we say you we worship. So in English, if you put the object before the subject, it means it's specifically for that thing. So if I say you Muhammad, bring my key, right? I've put you before, or Muhammad, I want to bring my key. I put Muhammad first. But if I say I want Muhammad to bring my key, how come Muhammad can bring it, anybody else could bring my key? Do you understand? So in this ayah, you, once you put the object first, it means you, Allah Azza wa Jal, alone we worship, wa iyaka nasta'een. And that's why this ayah in Surah Al-Fatiha, iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een, they said this is the center of the message of all of the messengers of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because the Quran, they said all of the Quran is gathered in iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. And this is Tawheed al-Ibadah. So in Surah Al-Fatiha, it helps you to memorize the three categories. Ar-Rububiyyah, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Asma al-Sifat. And Iyaka Na'bud wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Tawheed, what? Al-Ibadah. And there's another ayah in Surah Maryam, which helps you to memorize the three categories of Tawheed. And what is the ayah? The saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, is the Lord of the heaven and the earth. فَعْبُدُهُ. What tawheed is this? رُبُبِي. لَا. فَعْبُدُهُ. عِبَادَة. وَاسْتَبِرْ لِعِبَادَتِهِ. هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيَّةً. هَلْ, do you know anybody that's got the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, Asma Sifa? Before that, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. That's a الرُّبُبِيَّة. So these three categories are important to know. Now, huh? No problem. No. Naam. Two categories. Inna Allah Rabbi, Rububiyya wa Ibadah. And it's a good point as well that many times in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mention Rububiyya to prove what? Ibadah. Because the people already accept that Allah is their Lord. So Allah Ta'ala will use the Lordship to establish what? Ar-Rububiyyah. So the first command in the Quran, where's the first command in the Quran to show the importance of Tawheed? When you start from Fatiha, you go to Baqarah. Where's the first command, imperative command in the Quran? In Surah Baqarah, Ya ayyuhan nas, u'budu rabbakum. That's the first command in the Quran. And how does Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala establish that only Allah Azza wa Jalla should be worshipped? U'budu rabbakum, worship your Lord. Alladhi khalaqakum, the one that created you. Walladhina min qablikum, and the ones who came before you. La'allakum tattaqoon. Then Allah Ta'ala started to show them, He's the only Lord, He's the Creator. Alladhi ja'ala lakum al-arda firasha, was-samaa bina'a, wa anzala min as-samaa. And Allah Ta'ala mentioned all the things He's done for them. Fala taj'alu lillahi andadan, do not make rivals unto Allah. Wa antum ta'lamun. So when you find rububiyyah in the Quran, is to establish what? Ibadah. And that's why the first message Allah Ta'ala gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was iqra bismillah, la iqra bismi rabbik. Because the mushrikeen accepted Allah as their Lord. So there, that what follows after that will be easy for them to accept from uluhiyyah of Allah Azza wa Jal. Inshallah Ta'ala, we stop here and till next week inshallah. Subhanakallahumma hamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.